Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Johnson. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Monday, the 16th of August. India's health minister reviews COVID-19 situation in worst-hit Kerala state. Taliban declares war is over, chaos engulfs Kabul airport as Afghans attempt to flee. And Baloch and Sindhis in United Kingdom protest against atrocities by Pakistan. And now for all the details. Amid worrying coronavirus trends in southern Kerala state, India's Health Minister Mansukh Mandavia on Monday visited the worst-hit state and held a review meeting with top officials. Kerala in recent days has been witnessing more than half of the country's daily fresh infections.
India's Health Minister Mansukh Mandavia on Monday visited the worst-hit Kerala state to review the COVID-19 situation in the southern state, accounting for more than half of the country's daily fresh infections. Mandavia held a meeting with Kerala's Chief Minister Pinarayi Vijayan and other top officials to take stock of the measures being taken to curb the virus spread. Kerala currently has 179,155 active cases. It is the only state which has over 100,000 infections, with positivity rate of nearly 14%. A total of 18,601 deaths have been recorded in the state so far. Meanwhile, amid a decline in cases in other parts of India, more states including northern Uttar Pradesh and southern Andhra Pradesh on Monday reopened schools for classes 9 to 12, adhering to COVID-19 protocols. Schools and colleges across India have shut and moved classes online amid repeated lockdowns over the past year.
स्कूल फिर रीओपन हुए हैं, बच्चे आए हैं. प्रिकॉशन के लिए सैनिटाइजेशन, मास्क, हर चीज़ की अरेंजमेंट है और बच्चों को भी रोज़ सारी सेफ्टी रूल्स समझाए जाएंगे.
स्कूल्स ऑल्सो रीओपन फॉर क्लासेस फर्स्ट टू एट्थ इन इंडियाज ईस्टर्न बिहार स्टेट. एज ऑफ मंडे ओवरऑल कोविड-19 केस लोड इन द साउथ एशियन नेशन स्टूड एट 32.23 मिलियन विद 431,642 डेथ्स रिपोर्टेड सो फार.
Afghan nationals living in India on Monday expressed they were feeling a sense of helplessness a day after the Taliban seized the Afghan capital, Kabul. Around 200 Afghan nationals also arrived in New Delhi on Sunday to seek refuge as the crisis deepens in Afghanistan. Afghan nationals residing in Indian capital New Delhi said on Monday that they had not felt this helpless and hopeless ever. A day after Taliban insurgents claimed control over Afghanistan's capital Kabul, virtually unopposed. The Afghans expressed they were pained and worried for their family members back home, following the Taliban taking power. On Sunday night, around 200 more Afghans also arrived in New Delhi to take refuge in India as the crisis deepens in Afghanistan.
I have never felt it to this extent, helpless, hopeless, disappointed, poor and miserable in my life. All our 20 years achievement maybe just go in blinks of few days. I was a child when they were here, when they were there. Now I am an adult. I have seen how these people are. Yes, we are saved. US should leave the country, but why this way?
Earlier on Sunday, protesters including Afghan nationals angry over US President Joe Biden's administration for withdrawing from the country marched opposite the White House. The Taliban advances accelerated as the US and other foreign troops withdrew in line with President Joe Biden's decision to end America's longest war launched after September 11, 2001 attacks. In news from Afghanistan, the Taliban declared the war in Afghanistan was over on Monday after its fighters swept into the capital Kabul and took control of the presidential palace. On Sunday, President Ashraf Ghani fled the country, saying he wanted to avoid bloodshed. On Monday, Taliban fighters patrolled the streets of Kabul, and there were chaotic scenes at Kabul airport as people tried to flee the group's feared hardline brand of rule.
There was a strong Taliban presence on the streets of Kabul on Monday after Taliban officials declared the war over and foreign embassy staff were being evacuated from the capital. Taliban spokesperson Sohail Shaheen said in a message on Twitter, their fighters were under strict orders not to harm anyone. At least five people were killed in chaos at Kabul airport on Monday, witnesses said. It was not immediately clear how the victims died. A U.S. official said troops had fired in the air to deter people trying to force their way onto a military flight that was set to take U.S. diplomats and embassy staff out of the fallen city. The chaos came as Taliban officials issued statements aimed at calming the panic that has been building in Kabul as the militants, who ruled from 1996 to 2001, routed the U.S.-backed government's forces. In a video released by Taliban on Monday, Mullah Baradar Akhund, deputy of the Taliban, seated with a group of men, said it was now time to provide for the people and to improve their lives. The Taliban declared the war in Afghanistan was over on Monday after they took control of the presidential palace in Kabul. On Sunday, President Ashraf Ghani fled the country, saying he wanted to avoid bloodshed. Many Afghans fear the Taliban will return to past harsh practices in their imposition of Sharia or Islamic religious law. Meanwhile, U.S. President Joe Biden has faced rising domestic criticism after sticking to his predecessor Donald Trump's plan to end America's longest war launched two decades ago. The U.S. ferried embassy staff out of helicopters on Sunday, and the Pentagon authorized another 1,000 troops to help evacuate U.S. citizens and Afghans who worked for them.
Moving on, Baloch and Sindhi activists staged a protest in London this past weekend to observe August 14 as Black Day, the day when Pakistan was formed in 1947. They said people in Sindh and Balochistan have been facing human rights abuses by Pakistan over 7 decades now, and urged the international community to intervene to stop the ongoing genocide.
Baloch and Sindhi activists staged a demonstration outside the British Parliament in London this past weekend to highlight the ongoing human rights violations by the Pakistani state and its army against indigenous and ethnic minorities. The protesters chanted pro-freedom slogans while raising concern over rising incidents of enforced disappearances and extrajudicial killings of Sindhi and Baloch people. They termed August 14, the day when Pakistan was formed, as a black day and said it is the day when cultural genocide and ethnic engineering started against their communities.
There is human rights abuses are going on, there is genocide going on, cultural genocide going on in Sindh, and actual genocide is going on in Balochistan. There is hundreds and thousands of people have been disappeared by Pakistan, and Pakistan is still supporting Talibanization. Pakistan is still supporting terrorism.
The activists also expressed concern over socio-economic and political suppression and exploitation of natural resources by Pakistan in Sindh and Balochistan. They have long been requesting the international community to take notice of their peaceful struggle and have demanded intervention to stop Pakistani atrocities.
In news from Sri Lanka, amid concerns over the spread of the highly infectious Delta variant of COVID-19, Sri Lankan authorities have announced nationwide night curfew beginning from Monday night until further notice. As part of the new curbs, all public gatherings have been banned, while inter-provincial public transport remains suspended.
Amid concerns over the spread of the highly infectious Delta variant of coronavirus in Sri Lanka and cases tally surpassing the 350,000 mark, the government on Sunday announced a nationwide night curfew from Monday onwards until further notice. As part of the new curbs, authorities have decided to ban all public gatherings and the restaurants are allowed to operate with 50% capacity following the rapid surge in infections. The government also banned all weddings at homes and reception halls would be banned from August 27. The public transport among provinces remains suspended. However, essential services will be allowed on the roads to complete their work. The island nation this month ramped up its vaccination program. Last Friday, authorities announced it would be mandatory from September 15 to carry vaccination cards, certifying both doses of the coronavirus vaccine have been administered for inter-provincial travel. As of Monday, Sri Lanka reported over 354,960 total confirmed cases of COVID-19 and more than 6,000 deaths so far.
Moving on to news from Bangladesh. Commonly known as Sapla, water lily is the national flower of Bangladesh. Though horticultural enthusiasts admire the flower for its quiet grace, farmers in Bangladesh harvest water lilies as a crop. They are an important cash crop for many families in rural Bangladesh as they can be processed into delicious dishes. Villagers in Munshiganj district, some 16.7 miles south of capital Dhaka, are making a living by selling water lilies collected from washed swamps inundated during the monsoon season, from June to October. The livelihood of some wetland farmers is based on water lily farming. Local farmers were seen taking their little boats to fetch water lilies and sell them at the market. As farmers are left virtually unemployed during the monsoon, also called as lean season, poor families in villages in the district collect and sell water lilies to earn income. Since water lily is aquatic flower that grows all over Bangladesh, there is no need to cultivate it. An Indian sculptor from western desert state of Rajasthan has created captivating statues depicting the 12 poses from popular sun salutation yoga poses to promote health awareness in the country. Sculptor Pavan Kumar Bhatt from India's western desert state of Rajasthan has created captivating statues depicting the 12 poses of popular sun salutation yoga poses to promote health awareness in the country. Sun salutation or Surya Namaskar is a yogic exercise consisting of 12 gracefully linked poses of asanas that are said to be healthy for the whole body. Bhatt said he wanted to promote healthy practices among Indians thinking about coronavirus times. Bhatt has not installed any clothes, jewelry or even a face of hair in the statues of yoga, citing reasons. He says that yoga is not just some physical exercise, but takes care of the entire well-being of a person, including mental and spiritual.
वेशभूषा से क्या होता है कि थोड़ा सा हम किसी को वो करते हैं कि भाई ये फला धर्म का है, ये दूसरे धर्म का है, तो हमने ये नहीं बनाया बिकॉज मैं चाह रहा था एक अब्स्ट्रैक्ट फॉर्म में आए, हमें जस्ट मैसेज देना है, हमें किसी कंट्रोवर्सी किसी भी उसमें नहीं जाना है. हालांकि ये पौराणिक हमारा हिंदू धर्म का ही एक है, बट मुझे फिलहाल मैं चाह रहा था हेल्थ वाइज लोगों को इसका बेनिफिट मिले, इस मूर्ति को ये जहाँ भी लगे पब्लिक प्लेस पे इसको देख के लोग इंस्पायर हों.
Yoga is an ancient Indian Hindu practice gaining popularity across the world among health enthusiasts. The United Nations in 2014 declared June 21 as the International Day of Yoga after adopting a measure proposed by Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The day is marked by mass practice of yoga and other healthy activities across the world.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/isasianewsline and follow us on Twitter at isasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.